You're listening to Dots, Lines, and Destinations, a travel podcast with hosts Stephen Seagraves, Foz Mamoon, and Seth Miller. Yeah, so this Alaska Virgin merger thing, like, it's finally going to go through, you think? Maybe?
Maybe. I think it'll go through. I don't think there's a reason not to, even as it's sort of, you know, arguably Alaska paid too much, and arguably there's challenges in terms of, you know, what they're really going to be able to realize.
Yeah.
When it comes to, you know, picking up customers, they're still not going to be huge relative to the big four. They're, you know, just big enough to keep fighting, but they're still not huge. So that's going to be challenging. The flip side of it is they've got that fancy new livery now.
I mean, do you think, like, so they're going to give up 5 slots at SFO and LAX, right? That's the total? Are they giving up 5 at each? Or are they giving up 5 gates? I couldn't remember.
I don't know, actually. I know there were some gates and some slots was rumored. I don't think it's been formally confirmed. And I was also in Europe for a couple of days, so I stopped paying attention. Sorry.
Yeah, no, that's fine. I just think it's interesting because I almost felt like Alaska wanted it to fail, like wanted the DOT to go, nah, not going to happen.
Yeah. And that goes to they overpaid, and it would be interesting. I mean, if that happened, Alaska would be, I think it's a little bit damned if you do, damned if you don't at this point. Like, yes, it's a lot of cash to put out there and try for something, but if it fell apart at this point, what would they do? I mean, try to rekindle that organic growth.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, is the only choice they have, but it worked great up until the point that they've, you know, sort of hit the penetration they can on the West Coast. There's not a ton more they can do in the big cities without buying their way in. This is, you know, in many ways the same problem Southwest realized trying to expand at LaGuardia or National or Atlanta. The only way to get in to those bigger airports was to buy in.
Yeah.
I mean, and
it didn't work out
doing
well.
This. Yeah. Well, I don't know. I mean, Southwest more or less scaled back Atlanta, but they're doing decently at LaGuardia and at DCA. So I'm not sure it didn't work well, but it's happening.
I mean, I guess what I mean is they haven't, like, the growth that they wanted to accomplish at those airports. Yeah, they got some growth because they have gates there and they have flights there. But to say that they're having this big expansion and they're going to make these kind of like these new mini hubs, I don't think that's happened. Like, I mean, that was some of the idea was that Atlanta and DCA was going to be this big play for them. And DCA is decent, right? But it's not like they're the dominant carrier at DCA.
No, absolutely not. They still never had enough slots. And I mean, even Atlanta, they actually ended up, Southwest ended up scaling back versus what they had originally.
Yeah.
But they also kept a lot of the business routes and scaled back some of the leisure stuff. That's interesting to see how that's developed in the couple of years since the merger. But, you know, I think that overall there's opportunity for Alaska with the merger, even giving up some slots. It's just going to be interesting to watch.
Because, I mean, some of the rumors are that the DOJ is saying you can have this merger if you give up 2 to 4 gates in both San Francisco and Los Angeles.
Right.
And terminate the co-chair agreement with either Delta or American.
Right.
Or both.
The Delta one should be pretty easy to cut.
Yeah, I don't think they'll have a problem with that. I think that's an interesting, like, piece of the negotiation to me is the co-chairs. Because does that really affect the competitiveness if they're co-chairing? I mean, to me, it makes it more competitive because these co-chairs, the co-chairs aren't themselves very competitive when you look at the prices that Alaska, you know, when they sell an American flight as an Alaska co-chair, it's not very cheap usually because they're selling into higher buckets on American.
Yeah, well, I mean, in theory, that's they may or may not have access to the lower buckets on any given flight, and right, it's not a guarantee that it's always going to be more expensive. Sometimes it does go the other way.
Yep.
So that's part of it, but I think, you know, it's the co-chairs do matter in that context. They really do represent a significant increase in what the network looks like, even if it's not for reals.
Yeah. Yeah. So it makes it puffs up your network, even if that's not really what you're flying. Your partners are flying it.
Yeah.
Makes sense. 2 to 4 gates probably wouldn't kill them at LAX or SFO, but part of the reason for this merger was to gain more access at both of those airports.
Sure. And, you know, for all of these, you know, American and U.S. Airways had to give up gates at LaGuardia and DCA, right?
Yep.
So it's not uncommon to have to give up some gates when at the highly contested airports. Part of the fun will be determining who gets them and how that happens. One of our friends and writer for Flight Global wrote, you know, on his Twitter account, is the best part of these is the filings that the other airlines make when those slots come up for grabs. Because they're ridiculously entertaining.
Well, I mean, you think about San Francisco. I'm just thinking because I know that terminal a little bit. Like, who else is going to move in there? Like, United's not going to put flights out of there at those gates because it's gates. It's not necessarily slots. It's actual physical gates.
Yeah.
So who's going to move over there?
I don't know. I mean, could you see Southwest trying to expand? Could Frontier or Sun Country or JetBlue try to expand?
Maybe JetBlue. Maybe Spirit.
I mean, JetBlue at San Francisco's in the international terminal.
True.
Spirit could try to expand. Like, part of it is not necessarily you get those specific gates. There could be other shuffling to make it happen, but it's total gates does change.
Yeah. So do you think they'll kill both code-sharing agreements, or do you think they'll just kill Delta and move on?
I would say unless they have to kill American, they won't.
Yeah.
So if they can get away with just killing one, they should.
I think that American has propped up their network significantly with those code shares. I think it's probably the better of the code share agreements. I will miss Delta's reward space, though, because it's quite a bit better than American's, if that goes away. Do you think the partnership will go away completely?
Oh, yeah. I mean, that partnership's been on the rocks and ready to die for a long time. I think they've just been waiting for a good reason to do it.
Yeah, I mean, but I think that the
or a way to get through it in some way that doesn't involve breaking contracts. That's you know, whatever.
But the sweet spot really is Delta's reward availability. You can almost always find Delta reward availability from the West Coast to Europe pretty easily. American, not so much. You're forced to take BA. So yeah.
No, that's right. American doesn't actually have that much lift across the Atlantic versus Delta either.
Oh,
so that's part of it.
Really?
Yeah, total flights. American is
that's true. Yeah,
the lowest of the three.
We've talked about that before.
Yeah.
Interesting. You were mentioning something about American and who was it? Delta kind of going at it with another route, right? It's LAX to is it BJS? It's Baja.
Beijing.
That BJS. How you put this in the show notes? I'm like, what? What is this?
Sorry. BK. Does that help?
Yeah, that helps. That helps a lot more. So American got LA Beijing over Delta. They got picked.
Yes.
We'll make that the line for this show.
One of many. It's a lines episode. You know, what's interesting about that in many ways is that Delta had applied for that route first. It's a limited, you know, there's only so many slots. Delta applied for the rights for this final, basically, U.S. allocation into Beijing or Shanghai in this, like, the tier one cities. And Americans saw that application and chased after it a couple weeks later. And
Was Delta's American offering just not as good, do you think? Or is it just this... They just felt that American was more deserving for whatever reason.
It's hard to know. I haven't read the DOT filing. I've only read some of the quick reports on it. But it's one of those things. I don't know how or why the DOT ever really decides this sort of thing. Arguably, American makes a better claim for LA as a hub for better feed.
Yeah,
would be my guess. And so that right. And if you're the DOT, that serves the public interest. Delta is going to push most of its feed through Seattle, in theory.
Gotcha.
Of course, you know, only one of them can actually get this flight. But that's, you know, it's not like they can move it to Seattle for Delta. But
well, I think Delta already has Seattle, Beijing.
Does Delta already have Seattle?
Yeah.
So then, yeah, that they're pushing. Then I guess the DOT is saying keep that feed. American's existing operations are Chicago and DFW to Beijing, which are, you know, are what they are, but neither of those is good for West Coast travel. So United's got San Francisco, obviously. And I actually think United has LA also, doesn't it?
They do LA, Shanghai.
Okay.
Yeah.
So not quite.
Which is, you know, we should talk about that, though, because, like, I watched the San Francisco-Shanghai flights, because there's two of them now, because after they got that second slot. And that one flight leaves really late. It leaves around midnight from Shanghai back to San Francisco. And even the flight going over to Shanghai, it's been – I watched it pretty much every day. It's half full almost all the time.
Yeah. Well – either their demand isn't really there, or it's taking them longer to build it up, or. But it's like Air China also has the LA Beijing flights a couple times a day.
And with issues of airspace congestion and stuff, what's that?
They do that three times a day.
Yeah.
Air China.
Yeah. They do like a midnight flight, and they do like early morning, right? And then I think one midday.
There's one of them's not daily, but they do. Yeah, there's a midnight flight, 10:30 a.m. and a 1:30 p.m.
And 1:30 is one that's not daily, I don't think.
That's for the winter season. It looks like the 10:30 is not daily.
Oh, okay. But, I mean, that's a lot of lift to Beijing.
Yeah. Which is, right, that's the smaller of the two cities in terms of certainly importance business-wise. But
yeah, versus Shanghai. Do you think, though, that the air congestion in places like Beijing and Shanghai, with the airspace just being so full and delays and everything, do you think that American and Delta in particular will start looking at tertiary cities in China, similar to what the Chinese airlines have done and similar to what United's done?
They've gone on record as saying no, not now.
Both
Delta,
of them.
Delta especially has its China Eastern connections, right? They are actually, I think that's an investment deal where they're a part owner now, and they're waiting for open skies and antitrust immunity so they can make that deal even stronger, just like United wants to do with Air China.
Yeah.
But although United doesn't have the investment yet. But, you know, Delta is still depending on hubs to push its people through. It also doesn't really have a U.S. hub from which to operate all those secondary cities.
Yeah.
where they can't do it out of Seattle right now until it gets expansion in the North Concourse and whatnot, so that they have the customs facilities and the capacity. Delta's not growing there at all, and that's going to be a few years.
Yep.
So Delta doesn't have anywhere to put secondary city flights into. And American could, in theory, do it from L.A. It would probably have to give up some other flights or gates. Sort of, you know, it's running into limits, too. LAX is pretty full.
Yeah, I mean, you'd think that they could maybe push some of their London Heathrow. London Heathrow flights to BA or something. But, that makes sense. I was just thinking, because it seems like it's a great way to expand if you're going to expand into China anymore, unless they feel like China's going to be weak in the future.
Yeah. I don't know. It's because one could argue that the United routes aren't doing great. I think the company has said they're doing much, much better than they expected. So from what the company was, you know, looking for on numbers, they say they're doing great. I don't know if that's load factors, yields, total revenue, you know, number of bags of peanuts given out on board. It's hard to know exactly what the metrics are, but probably not peanuts on board. But, you know, it's... the company says they're doing better than expected. So
we have to take that for what it is, right?
The flip side of that is the VP responsible for that network expansion now works at WestJet.
I don't know if that's an upgrade or a downgrade. Not really sure.
Well, right. This is part of the Munoz house cleaning. Yeah. Basically, everybody's senior is gone. So, you know, I don't think it's necessarily a judgment against his ability to build the network and the results he delivered so much as just trying to rebuild the trust and sort of executive tier within the company. But,
yeah. So kind of taking it back to the original question of how's China doing and will we see expansion to those third-party cities, those tertiary cities, Chinese airlines have been picking up some of that slack, mostly because they can't fly out of the bigger cities, the tier one cities, right? They can't. There's just no more slot space for them.
I actually think China might have a couple slots they can still allocate, but China as a sort of, because the government plans all of its economics, even with the airlines and routes still, they sort of have a one airline, one route policy.
Yeah.
So Air China flies LA Beijing, China Eastern is not going to get that route.
Yeah. They fly Guangzhou to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So given that they have, you know, all these sort of secondary cities are getting their own airlines to be able to add more routes, right? Yeah. I mean, we were talking about Donghai or something like that.
Yep.
Right. And what's weird is there's actually a couple big companies, and some of them, like Sherpo in HNA, is Henan Airlines, but it also owns a bunch of other random airlines in China. They're not random, a bunch of other airlines within China. And, you know, they sometimes they cooperate, sometimes they don't, but it's sort of a big company that can handle some of the overhead management and then a bunch of airlines operating within. And since there's minimal competition on the routes, they all sort of do okay.
Yeah. I mean, it's kind of like when I was looking to go to Hong Kong with you guys, I actually looked because Xiamen Airlines started service to Seattle, I think, or maybe Vancouver, one of the two, and it to Shenzhen, which is like the most random thing, but it's right across the harbor from Hong Kong, so they can't get Hong Kong rights, but they can get Shenzhen rights.
Don't forget Hong Kong is actually sort of different.
Yeah, I know, but I'm just saying, like, they don't necessarily fly from that city to Xiamen. They fly, you know, Shenzhen. So it's not like they're flying based on these territorial things. They're flying basically where they can get a route.
That is a big part of it for the Chinese airlines. And, you know, Shenzhen is still a very big business, sort of manufacturing factories part of China. And so there are business people coming and going.
And if you know what, if you can get the Chinese visa beforehand, like I didn't have it, so I wish I would have, because it's actually not that hard to get over to Hong Kong from Shenzhen, from what I've read.
Yeah. Is that one of those that has like a ferry also?
It's like a ferry and a train.
Okay.
So I think you can take it directly from the airport, the train, to the ferry station, and then straight into Hong Kong.
Interesting. So. Yeah, I know. Like, I've been to Macau, which I guess we'll talk about later, or if we can talk now, whatever.
Yeah, we just segued right into it, man.
Yeah, man. I should have even tried to stop. I was in Macau, and one of the fun things there is that you can airside sort of after arrivals or before departure, you can take the ferry from Macau without having to re-clear Hong Kong immigration. So you take it straight to a pier at the airport. And they, you know, truck you through.
So you never actually enter Hong Kong. You enter
if you have the choice.
Okay.
If you've pre-booked it like that and done your bags correctly and some other things, you can basically connect at Hong Kong to or from the ferry at Macau.
Wow, that's nice. If you're going to Macau,
it's cool. Yeah, and Macau has an airport, but it's smaller. It is significantly smaller, sort of one runway built on out over the water. It's basically a pier, which is, you know, both cool and creepy, I guess. Like, makes LaGuardia look very, very stable. But yeah, it's got this, you know, runway out in the water and a small terminal that can handle a few flights, but it's mostly narrow bodies there.
And what did you think of Macau? I mean, everyone kind of talks it down a little bit because it's so touristy and so much like Las Vegas, but.
So I skipped, Macau is sort of like three islands, I guess. and there's the old part is the northernmost of the islands, and then as you go further south, the second island down is all the new casinos now.
Okay.
I did not go there. That's also where the airport is. I landed and sort of drove past some of them on my way up to the northern island, which is where, you know, the older Portuguese territory was. But I didn't touch the new stuff. I didn't go to the casinos. That's not my game, not my bag. And so I didn't do it, but I needed somewhere to stay for a couple of days. And it turned out that Hong Kong was stupid expensive hotel wise for, what do we decide? There's a lighting convention.
It was a lighting convention of all things.
Yeah. But, you know, and I wanted to fly Tiger Airways, and I wanted to fly the line and the dot from Macau.
Yeah. How was Tiger?
LCC, but, you know, not particularly egregiously so.
Okay.
Would be my overall judgment on there. I mean, the food was not very good. There was some weird, like, the messages I got, the emails kept saying you need an email of your PNR, you know, of your reservation to get through and check in. And you can't just, like, show it on your phone. You need the physical printout. And for whatever reason, I didn't have that. I forgot to print it before I left and then didn't have time along the way. And when I got there, I mentioned it on Twitter and people were like, yes, you do. No, you don't. It was very conflicting. Even their Twitter team eventually replied after I was sitting on the plane. So not very timely. But they replied, yes, you absolutely need that print out to be able to check in. And when I wrote back, actually, I didn't, and I'm sitting on your plane right now, they were very confused. So
that sounds about right. I mean,
yeah, I mean, I was warned they have terrible delays and this and that. It's an LCC, and, you know, based in Singapore, they've got their mediocre operations in many ways. Interesting of note, shortly after I flew them, it was announced that they would be merged into Scoot, which is the other LCC.
I was actually going to ask you, because I actually originally thought you were flying Scoot when you posted a picture of the cabin.
I did.
Yeah.
Well, I flew Scoot from Bangkok down to Singapore, and then Tiger Air from Singapore to Macau.
Gotcha. Okay. That's
it's cool. Getting harder and harder to keep track of which ones I've flown to make sure I get new ones every time.
Just don't fly, Bangkok Airways? What's the one?
Bangkok Airways is okay. That's the narrow bodies and relatively new planes. You're thinking about the one with the crazy old jumbos, right?
Thai Orient or something?
Yeah, Thai Orient, I think. Yeah, they, you know, I kind of want to just to say I did, but I'm not entirely sure I trust them.
So you spent how many days in Macau then?
I ended up spending 2 nights there.
Okay. So you got a little bit of time there. That's nice.
A little bit of time. So I had my first night, I sort of landed and walked around a little bit, grabbed some dinner. I was there during their film festival, which would have been cool if I'd gotten to go. One of the things they did was an outdoor performance. They showed a Charlie Chaplin film. Apparently he spent some time there back in the day. And they did it with because they're silent films that were, you know, with musical accompaniment. They had the local orchestra play the musical accompaniment.
Oh, that's cool.
And I was walking by and saw the dress rehearsal the night before.
And then you had to leave.
No, I just couldn't figure out how to get tickets the next night.
Oh, that sucks. That would have been kind of fun.
I went to the websites, and honestly, I didn't try that hard. I probably could have got someone at the front desk asking me, but I assumed that they would have been sold out because it was, you know, a neat thing, and I was tired. But yeah, it was neat just to sort of see that. You know what I would say about Macau? The old Portuguese part of it is interesting, but it's not really Portuguese. Like, there's a church and they've got the black and white tiles and the fun patterns on the sidewalks. So it definitely has that. All the language, all the signs still have Portuguese as one of the languages, but it feels like it's for show.
Oh, like it's not like this was actually the historic area. This is, we just put this here because people.
Well, no, I think it was built that way. I think it was built that way originally. And just there's no one Portuguese left. There's still options for some food, and I didn't get a good Portuguese meal. That was my fault. Shame on me. But yeah, I should have gone searching for that meal to try it out. You know, I like dumplings too.
The producer would have told you would have had to get some, what are they, nata? The egg custards.
Yeah.
But I mean, I think it'd be cool to go just to see kind of the difference in food between Macau and Hong Kong because they are so close. And so does Macau, I don't know if you know this off the top of your head, do they speak Cantonese or do they speak Mandarin?
I have no idea.
Because, I mean, Hong Kong is Cantonese, right? And it's the majority language spoken. But it's like one of the few places where it's spoken. So I was just wondering. We don't have the producer on the show, so I can't give facts. Just to see the differences because, I mean, it doesn't look anything like Hong Kong. Like Hong Kong is this like towering city. And when I was looking it up, because I was considering meeting you
Macau doesn't have that stuff at all.
Yeah, it doesn't have that towering, everywhere you look, it's just, you know, giant building. It doesn't.
No, and it's a much smaller place. I mean, so that's an interesting aspect of it.
Did it feel as crowded? Like,
Yes. Then Hong Kong, yes, absolutely.
Okay.
And one of our friends who lives in Hong Kong said they're getting fewer and fewer mainland visitors into Macau. And I was there on a weekend even, and it felt, people saw, some people commented on the picture I took in the main square, that I got a shot with almost no people in it. at 10 o'clock on a Saturday morning and how that was like impossible.
Yeah, interesting.
You know, the traffic was still bad. I got stuck. You know, I got out of my taxi and walked at one point because the traffic was so bad. So I don't think it was that empty.
You just like, pull over here, I'll walk. You did the very New York thing, didn't you?
Yes. Oh, yeah. Well, I think he was suggesting it also. There was definitely a language barrier, but there was some gesturing and this and that. Also, the taxis there, I think it was Macau, they open for you. They open the door for you.
Oh, like get out and do that?
No, there's a handle inside that opens the back door.
Interesting.
So it's weird because I'm just not used to it. It's like I would grab the door to open or close it and like freak them out. Pretty sure that was Macau.
Wow.
Yeah. Little cultural adjustments here and there.
Definitely. So one other topic before we talk about alliances. I was going to talk about that. I forgot about this, and I don't know if
you have
another line. I have another line. So St. Martin, Amsterdam is no longer a 747, which makes me really sad.
Yes.
I mean, they replaced with an A330, which is cool. Yeah. But just those videos of a 747 taking off and landing at St. Martin from KLM was probably one of the coolest things out there. This wide body landing on this little narrow itty bitty runway. So.
Yeah, it is cool. I've been down there to see it in person, and it is absolutely incredible. That I liked. You know, arguably the 330 is better in the sense that they get nonstop service now both directions. It used to be a tag flight through Curacao.
Yeah.
There are some benefits to it, but it's still, from a nostalgia perspective, I mean, it used to be a DC-10 at one point. Sorry, an MD-11. I'm sorry, KLM had the MD-11s. But yeah, the first time I was there in 08 or 09, it was an MD-11 landing.
That's cool. That's really cool.
Yeah.
I think you're not going to see, you don't see many 744s. I guess British Airways has a couple to some of the islands. I think they do one to like Bridgetown or there's a few other ones too. But that's really it anymore. I mean, they used to, 747s used to do Curacao. So I think that goes to an A330 now too.
Yeah. I think it may be 74 still seasonal.
Yeah. And so it's,
well,
it's.
Also, they're getting rid of the 74s.
Yeah. That's the real gist, is that the 74s are going away. Deltas will be gone very soon. United's
retiring there.
Yep.
BA is keeping theirs a little longer.
Yep.
I flew over to Belgium last weekend for work and sort of had a bit of a grin and smile as I booked it because I was able to score another BA 747. That's basically where I get them all the time now.
That's on JFK London Heathrow. That's like your bread and butter 744 route.
Yeah, at this point, I mean, they do like four or five of them a day. So
interesting. I was looking because I'm kind of a plane geek, so I kind of look up where some of these birds are flying, like not just 744s, but I was looking up Airbus 340-500s. So Etihad still has theirs.
Okay.
And so they do.
They fly like shorter haul though, right?
Yeah, they do stuff like in the Middle East, Abu Dhabi to a bunch of different places in the Middle East. And then Azerbaijan Airlines still has theirs. They only have two of them, but I can't find out where they fly. Like, I still haven't figured that out.
Interesting.
Because I would love to get one of those before they go away, because it's the one 340 type I don't have yet.
Okay. So, Azerbaijan, you said?
Azerbaijan, yeah. So are you typing it into your...
Yeah, I'm looking up.
I mean, there's just some planes like that. I think because the A350s and the 787s are coming online rather quickly, and airlines are retiring their older planes at the same rate, pretty much. A lot of the classic planes are going away. I mean, pretty soon you're not going to have a 767-200 out there. There's not that many now, I don't think.
Yeah.
So I think ANA or JAL has a couple, and then there's some other carriers in the Middle East and Russia that have them. So 752s, you know, they probably aren't long for this world.
Well, I think we probably got 8 to 10 years of 752s at least. So.
True. But and then the last story I wanted to talk about was British Airways and Emirates CEOs agreeing about something, and that is that airline alliances don't matter anymore.
Yeah. It's an interesting point of view. It's not that alliances, I think, you know, completely don't matter. It's that there are alliances and there are alliances.
Yeah.
So it's what they're saying is basically that the joint venture operations are what really matter.
Yeah.
And that's not a surprise. That's not new, right? We've talked about this, I feel like, before. United's much more closely aligned with Lufthansa and Swiss and Air Canada than it is with, whatever other, even Brussels Airlines, which isn't part of the joint venture, right? Or they are now, maybe, but they weren't. Or then SAS. SAS is definitely not. Like, you know, they are more aligned with ANA than they are with Asiana. Because they have the joint venture into Asia and all of those onward ANA flights, that's why United was able to shut down its Narita hub.
Yeah.
Delta is far more aligned with Air France KLM and Alitalia and even Virgin, the Virgin Atlantic operation, which is joint venture immunized now, than it is with Korean.
Yeah, that's a good point.
It fights aggressively with, even though they're partners. Although there's some detente going on there, so we'll see how that plays out. And American is the same thing, where it has its joint venture partners. So those joint ventures truly are the holy grail, as it were. And it's just, it's hard to know if there's really anything else out there that could be equal or better than those joint ventures. I think the answer is probably no.
Yeah.
The challenge there is that getting those joint ventures are very hard and, you know, rarely happen. So it's a lot more of, you still need alliances, you still need partners. If you'd want true global coverage, you can't do it with just joint ventures today.
Yeah. Do you think then as kind of things shift, I mean, the model, like let's say Alaska's taken, they've said, we've got, they're not necessarily joint ventures, they're co-chair partners, and they're just partners with a bunch of people in different alliances. Is that kind of the model that the future holds? Is that what we're going to look at in the future? And it'll be more of these joint venture type models as well, where it's, you know, code shares and revenue sharing across oceans.
Maybe.
Yeah, that's a tough question. I just kind of threw that one out there.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's hard to know really which direction it's going to end up. I feel like I think the airlines mostly want them.
Mm-hmm.
But that it's really hard to make that actually work. Like governments don't want to give them out as often. Even the new Aeromexico Delta deal is only a 5-year approval.
Yeah, yeah. They're kind of testing the waters with it.
Yeah, here's the line I was looking for. Justin Bachman, who's a aviation and business reporter for Bloomberg. An immunized airline joint venture is a cow made of cash, gold, and other financial goodness.
Hmm.
Right? I mean, he's basically counting the holy grail. Everybody wants them. If you can get those over alliances, it is all sorts of glory. The problem is you can't truly build global coverage with just joint ventures.
Yeah.
The same way you can with alliances. So I agree that alliances are not as useful. I won't go as far as to say they're useless.
Yeah.
And I think you'll see more and more push to get to joint ventures where treaties, you know, you need open skies generally to get that as well. So where the treaties and other arrangements allow for it.
Yeah.
But with foreign ownership rules and all of those other restrictions, you're not going to see it everywhere.
Yeah, I think the one beauty of alliances, besides the whole governmental thing that you just mentioned, besides all that, alliances kind of allow this kind of singular experience through multiple airlines. I think that
in theory.
Yeah, I mean, in theory. But I mean, you look at Star Alliance and it's pretty good. I mean, you know what you're getting for the most part. Boarding in Europe is kind of crap because they don't enforce any of that. Who cares? But
as opposed to boarding in the U.S. where they do enforce it, it's still crap.
Exactly. But I think like other things like lounge access, things like that.
Yeah, like lounge access, baggage policies, some of the, you know, the theoretical seamless through check of itineraries and ticket issuing across carriers and all those things. There's a lot of good that comes out of alliances.
Yeah. I had this question. I'm flying Amsterdam, Vancouver, Portland on a mix of KLM and Alaska. And Alaska and KLM are partners.
Right.
And I'm in business class. But Vancouver, Portland is serviced by a Q400. And
so you're only in coach.
So it's in coach. So I asked the question. I said, will I have arrival lounge access in Vancouver based on my KLM business class ticket?
Nope.
Both of them said no, which I find kind of disappointing because I have 5 hours now because of schedule change in Vancouver. I can drive from Vancouver to Portland almost in 5 hours. So it's kind of annoying because of the partnership. Now, if it was like the Star Alliance, let's just say theoretically it was United and, I don't know, Lufthansa, I would probably have lounge access on arrival into Vancouver.
Only if you were Star Gold.
And if I was Star Gold. So
if you were just doing it based on business class, you would not.
Yeah.
So
I mean, yeah, so there's some quirks there. Yeah, it's not perfect. There's some quirks. But I think it's more clear than what you would get with partners. Because you don't know. I mean, it all depends. It's whatever that partner has negotiated with Alaska.
All right. I have an update for you.
Okay.
Azerbaijan no longer has the 340-500s on their schedule files.
Oh, man.
Yeah, one of them's been parked at Baku since October 15th, and the other one's been chilling out in Moscow for a week now.
This makes me sick.
Sorry.
I gotta go fly Etihad now. Dang it.
Okay.
Okay. What? I don't really want to.
I actually almost flew Azerbaijani to Dubai, so.
Their product looks, on the new 787s, looks quite good.
Yeah, I was gonna be on the 78, so. Yeah. They fly that to JFK now.
And I was looking up ticket prices and they're not bad. Just
thinking for a one way to Dubai, they were the cheapest option from New York.
Yeah, I mean, seems
in coach. I didn't look at business. My budget wasn't there. But
one other thing, last topic.
Can we go back to lines?
Yeah, we can go back to lines. I'm sorry. I just kind of jumped ahead.
That's okay.
We're trying this new format thing and, you know. Rumored Emirates routes. So there was this vague post on Flyer Talk about these two points on the map, on Emirates map on their website, about Buffalo and Phoenix. And people have said, well, right before they announced Fort Lauderdale showed up on the map. And so clearly, this is 100% true evidence that they're starting service to Buffalo and Phoenix.
To be fair, they've since been pulled off the map.
They've since been pulled off the map. Do you think this is possible? I don't see Buffalo happening anytime soon. I know that they're having a rift.
A proxy for Toronto.
Yeah, they're having a rift with the Canadian government and only being able to fly to Toronto, what, three times a week or something stupid.
Yeah.
And so they said, well, we can just fly to Buffalo and have people drive over, which people do anyway.
That's why JetBlue put an LAX flight there.
Yeah, and so I mean, that's possible, I guess, but the runway is barely long enough.
So it's 8,800 feet. I'm looking it up right now as we're talking because I had a feeling that was going to come up.
Of course it will.
Fort Lauderdale is only 9,000 feet.
Interesting.
And I think that's the new extended Fort Lauderdale. I'd have to confirm that's the new number.
And is Fort Lauderdale, do they say Fort Lauderdale will be weight restricted?
I don't know if it's weight restricted or not.
Because, from Fort Lauderdale, I guess you probably don't need maximum takeoff weight. And from Buffalo, then theoretically you wouldn't need it either, depending on the type of plane.
Well, it's going to be a 777.
200, I'm guessing?
Yeah.
Okay. So LR probably. So yeah, it should be okay.
Yeah. And right, it's not going to be fully loaded, but it should. And, you know, Buffalo is, it's a short, right? It's going to be only like 14 hours.
Yeah. I think with that, you probably are going to touch maximum takeoff, maybe. I'm not worried about the arrival. I think the arrival's fine.
And I'd say eastbound is a little easier because it's a little shorter and you got tailwinds.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think, they'll probably be okay. Phoenix is another technical, interesting one because of it's hot and high. So for our listeners who don't know that when conditions are hot and your altitude is higher, it takes more runway to take off. And so that one I do think is interesting because I'm not sure how they'll run that. I almost guarantee they're going to have to run it with weight restrictions if it happened.
In the summer. So, well, remember that, for better or worse, Emirates has a lot of experience operating in desert conditions.
Yeah, Dubai is their home. So, they know what they're doing. Phoenix doesn't make a ton of sense to me. I guess where else are they going to expand to at this point?
The commentary we saw was basically there's a lot of South Asia.
True.
VFR traffic in and out of Phoenix.
Yep. That makes sense. I'm actually surprised.
It's a long way around as opposed to going west at that point. But
I'm surprised they don't fly to Portland at that point either. They fly to Seattle already. But Buffalo makes the most sense. Of the two, Buffalo makes the most sense. Phoenix.
Yeah, and the Buffalo, when I first saw it, I was like, you've got to be kidding me. But when you remember that it's a proxy for Toronto, it's not the worst thing in the world.
Yeah, and we were talking about how, their American has kind of shifted away from Phoenix. Right? They're kind of like, they might just give
closing,
up on it.
Not closing, they cut a bunch of pilot positions there or something, right?
Yeah, I think they moved them to LA and DFW. So that's an interesting move. So maybe, it's a new hub for Emirates. I don't know.
Sweet.
Phoenix to Baton Rouge?
Hey!
Yeah, I don't know. Where else could they expand, I guess, is my question. Is there anywhere else on the map in the United States where Emirates could theoretically fly in the future?
Yeah, you got to look at what are relatively large cities with demand into South Asia.
Yeah, I'm interested to see if they start Detroit. I could see Detroit.
Yeah.
Easily.
They are using JetBlue right now feed through Boston for that.
Yeah. So eventually I could see that one coming to fruition.
Yeah.
Other than that, I'm not really sure there's much left unless they really just want to fly to every airport in Florida. But who knows?
Well, Emirates doesn't have Atlanta yet, right? Only Qatar?
Yeah. So, Atlanta makes sense if they can fight Delta on that one and win.
Yeah.
That would be good. Yeah, Baltimore.
Yeah, that becomes the question of, is there enough demand relative to fill both the Qatar plane and the Emirates plane?
Yeah, yeah.
And do they want to fight it out or let, each other go at that? BWI is an interesting one that you mentioned. They have Dulles already.
Yeah.
Do you put two so close together?
Yeah, I could see it just because you're serving kind of northern D.C. and Maryland via a Baltimore route.
Yeah.
I
absolutely see that convenience for, adding, sort of, if you wanted to add another frequency, maybe doing a PWI instead of an additional at Dulles would be a smart play.
Yep. Yeah. And they don't fly to Newark yet either, which is...
No, they do not.
And that's an interesting choice.
They've got four at JFK, four 380s a day.
Which, so that's kind of my point, though, is like, okay, so you got four 380s. Is everybody making the trek from New Jersey over to JFK?
I would imagine so.
So... you have this whole market that's not being served well, I guess. Not being served well. They're being served and it's not well. So I don't know. I mean, that's – I would watch out for
Newark. You can't put a 380 at Newark, so that's part of it.
Yeah, but I mean, a 772 would be perfect.
77W.
Yeah, or something like that. And hey, United, I'm just looking at you, United. You can always restart Dubai service. You laugh, sir, but based on what happened last night, anything is possible.
That's true. yeah, it's – that's an interesting opportunity.
We know it won't happen. And then tomorrow they announce.
Yeah. I think the Buffalo option is really the fun and interesting one.
Yeah, yeah.
Also, just in the sort of, okay, do whatever you want, but we've got our ways, kind of screw you to the Canadian government.
Yeah, yeah. And do you think that JetBlue then could pick up some flights out of Buffalo and offer some connecting traffic if they wanted?
Yeah, I could see that working. I mean, they already have some.
Yeah.
But, JetBlue has done – the problem at this point is that it's the places where they have onward traffic is all places Emirates also flies. LAX, Orlando, to Buffalo – or to Boston they don't, but I doubt – or they do. Right, they've got like JFK, like all the places you can get to from – Buffalo today are places that Emirates is already flying to. Fort Lauderdale, I think, is one of them. So that may not necessarily be feed there. I'm sure the folks in Buffalo would love to see expansion. I know when I did that LA inaugural with them a couple months back, it was they're talking up the region and its growth and, you know, being a good feed into Southern Canada and all of those options.
Yeah, interesting stuff. Interesting stuff.
Yeah.
I think anything else? Anything you can think of this week? Any depressing thoughts you want to share?
Yes. More pre-clearance.
Oh, yeah. Forgot about that.
Arlanda. Maybe that's our dot this week, is Stockholm's Arlanda Airport. I'm sure I'm saying it wrong.
Is getting pre-check.
They have actually signed the agreements. Apparently, they still need Swedish Parliament to agree to fund the construction, and it's going to take 3 years to get there. But by 2019, they hope to have pre-clearance or customs and immigration in Stockholm, of all places.
Interesting.
And what's really interesting to – oh, sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, because, I mean, that's Norwegians kind of – they have some flights out of Stockholm, right?
They have – it's – well, that's what I was going to – yeah, so we're on the same page. What was really interesting to me is the only year-round nonstop service is SAS and Norwegian.
Yeah.
And you remember when Abu Dhabi opened up its pre-clearance location, the U.S. carriers pitched an absolute fit saying, why are we giving these benefits to what's essentially Etihad?
Yeah, that's I can see them doing the same thing for this.
Yeah, I mean, Delta and United have had service in the past. They've gone seasonal with it. It's unclear if it's going to come back or not, especially given the Norwegian competition there and the LCC sort of push.
Some of these pre-clearance announcements really confused me. St. Martin, speaking about St. Martin earlier.
Yeah.
That one blows my mind just because.
Aruba, Bermuda, Bahamas. I'm pretty mama.
Yeah, I mean, but they're all confusing, right? I mean, it's not like
I actually see St. Martin working, believe it or not.
Really?
And maybe it's just I've been there too often, but which is only three times, I think. So clearly not that often. But it's the way it's built and what the sort of flow of flights is. There's sort of an afternoon bank where 8 or 10 departures all go, and they're all coming to the U.S. and to clear a couple thousand passengers a day would do. You know, would be nice.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's, you know, a couple thousand a day or 10 flights at 150 a pop is 1,500 a day. So you're talking about maybe 500,000 passengers a year. That's a relatively small airport for pre-clearance. Bermuda has like 350,000 a year or so, and it's at the small end.
Do you think that then all of the different Caribbean destinations, it's kind of validated that they should get pre-clearance?
Well, I think there's sort of a minimum viable volume of either flights or people, right? Kansai, yeah. You know, near Osaka is on the list, which is baffling to me. There's like a Delta flight, right?
KIX, K-I-X?
Yeah.
What was the United flight to San Francisco every day?
And United to San Francisco. So, and those are the only two nonstops in the United States, right?
Actually, no, there's another one to LAX on JAL.
Okay. There we go. Three flights a day.
And United doesn't operate there just daily, so.
Okay. Are there Hawaii flights? Maybe that might add to it a little bit.
There might be a couple of Hawaiian flights and from the ANA and JAL. I mean, I can totally see that.
So maybe with the Hawaii flights, it adds up and it makes sense. I'm trying to figure out some of them, like Rio and Sao Paulo. I get it from we're trying to get away from visas down there and like trying to push towards sort of, although that may change now, trying to push towards sort of common, you know, easier travel, and pre-clearance does that. But it's unclear just how viable that is given the drop in number of frequencies to especially Rio at this point.
Like, yeah.
I mean, capacity's down massively there from the U.S. carriers and even from the Brazilian carriers.
I mean, that's a great point. If I see why they're doing it, it's almost like an appeasement type thing. Like, hey, let's just calm things down in South America, especially with Brazil and visa prices and everything. But the traffic has dropped so dramatically. Is it effective?
Yeah. Can you predict what the traffic's going to look like in 5 years when these things might be built?
Yeah. And the fear for me is, like we've seen in Abu Dhabi, the pre-clearance stuff can be an absolute mess for people who are using it. So you go through pre-clearance, you're stuck there, really. You can go back out, but there may not be food options.
Immigration again.
Yeah, you got to go through immigration again. You may not have food and drink and all that stuff inside the pre-clearance area.
Dublin has had pre-clearance, you know, forever, quote unquote, for a long time now, and they only just got a lounge earlier this summer inside pre-clearance.
And so to me, it's like this, like, is immigration in the United States that bad?
You have to remember, this isn't about making it better for the passengers.
It's about making it better for who?
Customs. Immigration. They want to stop people from ever putting their feet down on American soil, even if you're in an airport where they can deport you back out.
Yeah, but so they have to show me that this actually works then. I would need like hard numbers, not.
They claim they blocked like 10,000 people, and I don't remember over what duration.
From where? Dublin?
All of them.
I want to be my own media organization, please. Like,
who are you going to ask?
Yeah, well, I mean, that's the thing. It's like, okay, so I ask.
No, you can't get the numbers from. I'm trying to find my story.
I'm sure we could do like an FOIA request.
Yeah,
and get the numbers. But
yeah, or just ask DHS and see if they'll tell you.
Yeah,
that's sometimes easier. Sometimes that works. I think I have the number somewhere here. I'll try to pull it up while we're wrapping up the show here. But it's their whole goal is to make it so that more and more people are caught at the end, not at the beginning before they get here.
Yeah, well, I get it. But at what cost? Like, what is it costing us to put agents in Abu Dhabi a year versus how many people? I'm sorry. I'm going political. I'm not going to go political in this episode. That's my point is like, okay, that means you're not doing a good enough job at the border in the country, right?
Well,
possibly.
Maybe. I mean, their theory is they never get here. The Abu Dhabi one, the government there is paying for it. So that's one of the ways they justified it.
Okay, that makes sense.
Here we go. At the point of an announcement in May 2015, Customs had 600 law enforcement officers and agricultural specialists stationed at pre-clearance stations around the world. Those offers denied admission to about 10,000 people in 2014.
Interesting.
So, and I don't know how many are denied once they get onto, you know, U.S. land versus this 10,000. But
I guess, I mean, that's one way to justify it, though, is if you're catching more people across the, over at their point of origin, then it's better. I mean, I get that.
It is. Is the 10,000 enough to justify the costs and whatnot?
What I find intriguing is when you do that, let's say when you say deny entry to somebody, are you let's say it's in Abu Dhabi. Let's say they don't have a UAE, wherever they came from, they don't have a UAE visa. And by denying them entry,
there's someone who's connecting.
Yeah, by denying them entry in the United States, are you basically who takes care of that? I would love to know that because
that's an interesting question. So I'm flying India, Dubai, or India, Abu Dhabi, New York, and I get stopped in Abu Dhabi, and I'm up from whoever I was in India. I don't have right to enter Abu Dhabi.
Yep.
Yeah, that's an interesting question.
Because technically, you're entering. I mean, you're kind of transiting securely, right? I mean, you're still in transit, and then you enter the United States. So they put you back in transit. I get that that's probably okay, but you can't stay in transit forever.
I know. That's Tom Hanks.
He is an expert on it. That movie.
All right. On that note.
No, I think that's a good question, though, to ask. So.
Yeah.
Anyway. Thanks for joining me today, Seth. We kind of decided to do this show in the middle of the day on Wednesday rather than our usual recording time due to the election and stuff. And I think it worked out. And our listeners can follow the podcast on Twitter at DotsLines. Online at moredotsmorelines.com. Thanks for listening. Talk to you later. Bye-bye.
Take care.